Hello, I'm Dr. Aizaz from Medicovisual.com, and in today's visual lecture, we will talk about the formation of allantois. Allantois is a structure that is formed during third week of development at about day 16. So here is the embryo at about day 16, and if we cut a section here, if we cut it from the middle and we remove the front part and we see it from here, from front, that let's suppose that you are standing here and you are looking this section from this side, this will be the picture that you will see. In this picture, you can see that this is the amniotic cavity, here is the yolk sac cavity, and here is the connecting stalk, and this is the extra embryonic mesoderm. Talking about the embryo proper, it consists of three germ layers, so it is the trilaminar embryo. This is the outer layer called ectodermal layer or ectoderm or embryonic ectoderm, and here is the embryonic endoderm. So ectoderm and endoderm, and in between these ecto and endoderm is the middle layer called mesoderm. Now what happens that at about day 16, an outpouching or diverticulum arises from the yolk sac cavity and it goes inside the connecting stalk. So this is the outpouching or diverticulum that arises from this yolk sac and it enters into the connecting stalk. This sausage-like diverticulum or outpouching is called allantois. So this is basically the allantois, and that is it about the development of allantois during third week of development. But to make your concept really crystal clear, we want to understand that what is the function of allantois? What is the significance of this structure? So in order to understand the structure of allantois, we will have to take a sneak peek into the future. So let's see what happens to allantois after third week. And for this, let's go to Blender for a 3D overview. So here is the embryo and outermost layer is called chorion. If we take a section of this chorion, you can see that we have cut a section of this chorion. And if we take a look here, so this is actually the this embryo, it is trilaminar embryo and it is surrounded by two cavities, actually three cavities. What cavity is this? This is the amniotic cavity, is that right? So here is the amniotic cavity, right? So amniotic cavity is surrounding the ectoderm, and here is the yolk sac cavity, and extra embryonic mesoderm, it is surrounding both of these cavities. And here it is forming the connecting stalk, which will later form the umbilical cord. Now what happened here is that, as you can see, that this is the yolk sac and it is forming that outpouching or diverticulum that has entered into this connecting stalk. So this structure is actually the allantois. So after this overview of allantois, now let's see what happens during fourth week of development. Now we are not talking about third week of development. Now we are having a sneak peek into fourth week of development. So what happens that during fourth week of development, folding of the embryo occurs. What I mean by this is that there will be three types of folding. This cranial folding, that here this embryo will move inward. And here there will be the caudal folding, that from here again this embryo will move inward. And then the third one will be the lateral folding, that will be on the transverse axis. So let's first see how the cranial folding occurs. We will not discuss the details of folding. We will have a separate lecture on folding. But to understand the function of allantois, you need to have some concept of folding. So let's take a look. So in this animation, you can see that cranial folding has occurred, and as you can see that as the cranial folding occurred, this part of yolk sac, so here is this yolk sac, this part of yolk sac, it has been incorporated into this part of the embryo. Similarly, what happens that here the caudal folding will also occur, and again as the caudal folding occurred, this part of yolk sac, it has also been incorporated into the embryo. So this is the cranial and caudal folding, and the third folding is the lateral folding. And in lateral folding, these lateral sides of the embryo, they will fold inwards like this. So this is the lateral folding, right? If we take a section of this embryo, here you can see the section of the embryo, and here you can see that this was the cloacal membrane here. You remember the cloacal membrane? Cloacal membrane is the structure in which there are only two layers of the embryo. There is the endodermal layer and there is the ectodermal layer, and there is no mesoderm in between. So this is the cloacal membrane. And now you can see that as a result of folding, this cloacal membrane, it has came ventral to the embryo. Previously it was here, now it has came ventral to the embryo. And the other thing that happened here is that here is the allantois, and now allantois is cranial to the cloacal membrane. Now what happens? Now this, what this allantois will do is that here this allantois will contribute towards formation of urinary bladder, right? So here this allantois will contribute towards formation of urinary bladder, and the remaining part of allantois, it will form a hollow tube, a hollow thickened tube that is called urachus. And this urachus, it will be connecting this urinary bladder to the umbilicus. Let's go back to PowerPoint. So here again, what happens that cranial folding as well as caudal folding here, and as a result of this caudal folding, you can see that this allantois, it came cranial to the cloacal membrane. So this is the cloacal membrane. It came cranial to the cloacal membrane. Then what happens that here a urogenital septum will arise, and it will divide this part, this incorporated part of yolk sac, into two parts. This part will be forming the hindgut, and this is the urogenital sinus that will contribute towards the formation of urinary bladder. And the remaining distal part of this allantois, this part here you can see this remaining part, it has entered into the umbilical cord. And this is called, what we call it, this is called urachus. So this is the urachus, and this is the part of allantois that contributes towards the formation of urinary bladder. Now what is the function of this allantois? One function you have already understood, that it contributes towards the formation of urinary bladder. The other function, the other part of allantois, which will form the thickened hollow tube called urachus, it connects the apex of this urinary bladder to the umbilicus. Now what is the significance of this structure, urachus? Now what happens that this is the oropharyngeal membrane. It ruptures, and here the mouth of embryo will form, and later on as it becomes fetus and primordial kidneys form, it will drink this amniotic fluid. This fetus will drink this amniotic fluid, right? It will drink this amniotic fluid, and his or her kidneys will form urine, and this urine will then be secreted back into this amniotic fluid. So this recirculation of amniotic fluid will continue, but this urine will not be excreted out of the body of this fetus. As we adults do, what we do is that we excrete out the urine, we excrete the urine outside our bodies. But fetus does not have such luxury, so they keep on releasing their urine into the amniotic fluid, and then they keep on drinking it, and this continue to recycle, and it continue to recycle. The important function of urine is to get rid of nitrogenous waste. But due to recircling, there isn't any mechanism to get rid of nitrogenous waste. So what happens that as the urine comes into this primordial urinary bladder, this urine will then go into this urachus, and here in this connecting stalk the umbilical blood vessels will form. So these umbilical blood vessels, what they will do, this is actually hypothesis, this may not be true, I will tell you later what happens. So here in this umbilical vesicle, through this urachus, the nitrogenous waste can go into this umbilical arteries, and this umbilical arteries, they can take it back into the placenta, and from placenta into the mother's blood, and from mother's blood this nitrogenous waste, they can be secreted out into her urine. This is especially true for lower organisms, but such role of urachus is controversial in humans. Some authors believe that this occurs in human, while others say that such mechanism does not exist for human. They say that urachus does not actively participate in excretion of nitrogenous waste, and it may be an evolutionary vestige only. So in summary, what are the functions of allantois? One is that it contributes towards the formation of urinary bladder, and the other is the controversial one, and that is excretion of nitrogenous waste. One theory is that it has some role in excretion of nitrogenous waste. The other theory is that it is an evolutionary vestige. But if it is an evolutionary vestige, then how come the fetus gets rid of the nitrogenous waste? Well, the answer is simple, through placenta. Finally, let's talk about the fate of allantois. As the baby is born, this urachus is no more needed. So what happens is that the lumen of this urachus is obliterated, it is closed, and it becomes a solid fibrous cord. And this solid ligamentous fibrous cord, it connects the urinary bladder to the umbilicus, or what we call as navel. So in born babies and adults, this urachus is no more called urachus. Its lumen is obliterated, it's a solid ligamentous cord, and now it is called median umbilical ligament. Remember, this is median umbilical ligament. It is not medial umbilical ligament. These two are separate structures. Medial umbilical ligament is something else. So this was about allantois. Thank you so much for watching this video.